Did you know the average person burns around 1800 calories of energy a day doing absolutely nothing?
Yep, you heard that right.
1800 calories doing absolutely nothing. You'll probably burn 12 calories or so just from watching this video. Not to mention the energy you'll burn from taking notes, stretching, thinking about what's for dinner.
That's right. Even thinking requires energy. And yes, thinking about how thinking costs you energy also costs you energy.
Every living thing needs energy to survive and flourish, from microscopic bacteria thriving in underwater volcanoes to majestic eagles soaring through the stratosphere. So, where do living things get all this energy from? And, more importantly, how is this energy captured and used in a reliable way? In today's lesson, we'll explore this and more as we describe three processes of cellular metabolism and explain how cells use each of these processes to obtain and utilize energy. Let's get into it. Cellular metabolism is the set of chemical reactions that occur in living organisms in order to maintain life. Remember, our bodies strive for homeostasis, or balance, and cellular metabolism, like cellular transport, is essential for maintaining this balance. While cellular transport deals with moving resources in and out of cells, cellular metabolism involves reactions that chemically change these resources, allowing cells to capture and store energy that is essential for their survival. There are three main forms of cellular metabolism we will discuss today, and they are photosynthesis, cellular respiration, and fermentation. To understand how energy flows through living things, we have to start with the source, the sun. The sun provides all of the energy needed to sustain life on Earth. Sunlight enables the growth of vast jungles, towering redwood forests, and sprawling grasslands, supporting life in countless ecosystems, including deserts, mountains, marshes, and tundras. It permeates our oceans, filtering energy into massive kelp forests and coral reefs, which in turn provide food and sanctuary for many other living organisms. So, if sunlight is the original source of energy, how do plants and other organisms capture the sun's energy to make Earth's rich ecosystems possible? The sun's energy is captured in a process called photosynthesis, which is a series of reactions occurring in the presence of sunlight that create glucose, or sugar. Photosynthesis occurs in specialized organelles called chloroplasts, which can only be found in some organisms, such as plants, algae, and special types of bacteria. The green color of this organelle, and consequently most plants, comes from the pigment chlorophyll, which is used to absorb the energy from sunlight. Once light energy is absorbed, it sets off a chain of reactions that is summarized by this equation. 6CO2 plus 6H2O plus sunlight yields C6H12O6 plus 6O2. C6H12O6 is the chemical formula for glucose, or sugar, which has 6 carbon atoms, 12 hydrogen atoms, and 6 oxygen atoms. Notice anything about our equation? If you count up all the carbons, hydrogens, and oxygens on each side, they match. Plants can't create glucose, nature's miracle food, out of nothing. The word photosynthesis comes from the words photo, meaning light, and synthesis, which means put together. Plants and other photosynthesizing organisms use chemical reactions to put together glucose, or sugar, using water, carbon dioxide, and energy from sunlight, while producing oxygen as a waste product.
Plants use the glucose they make in a variety of ways, but the main purpose is to help them grow. All plants on Earth, even this mighty redwood, start from humble beginnings, such as seeds or spores, and build themselves over time out of a starch called cellulose, which is basically a ton of glucose chained together. Plants also use glucose to build additional sugars, starches, and fats found in fruits, vegetables, seeds, and nuts. Plant-eating organisms then eat these resources, breaking them back down into glucose, giving rise to massive food webs. This glucose is relied upon for food by almost every living thing that can't photosynthesize. So it's hard to overstate the importance of this process. And that's not all. Trees and other photosynthesizing organisms act as natural air filters, regulating the amount of carbon in the atmosphere by taking carbon dioxide out of the air and replacing it with oxygen gas, which is a vital resource for many living things. In order to understand just how important oxygen is, we'll need to talk about a process called cellular respiration. Cellular respiration is a series of reactions occurring in the presence of oxygen, by which glucose is broken down to create ATP. ATP, or adenosine triphosphate, is a molecule that stores and carries energy within cells. Your cells are constantly spending ATP to survive, and cellular respiration is their way of replenishing it so they don't run out. The term respiration means the act of breathing. So you can think of cellular respiration as breathing at a cellular level. It is important to understand that it is our individual cells that need oxygen gas, specifically for this process of creating ATP, which is why we breathe at all. Cellular respiration occurs in the mitochondria, or powerhouse of the cell. It's worth noting that plants have mitochondria and do, in fact, perform cellular respiration as well. They just have the added benefit of making all the glucose needed for this process in-house. To find out what other materials are involved, let's take a look at the chemical equation for cellular respiration. C6H12O6 plus 6O2 yields 6CO2 plus 6H2O plus ATP. Remember, C6H12O6 is glucose. As you might notice, this equation for cellular respiration is very similar to photosynthesis, just in reverse order and involving stored energy as ATP instead of sunlight. With this process, organisms breathe in oxygen and consume glucose in order to produce stored energy, while expelling water and carbon dioxide as waste products. Carbon dioxide and water are then used by plants for photosynthesis to create glucose and oxygen, repeating the cycle. In this way, photosynthesis and cellular respiration complement each other, recycling each other's waste to maintain a healthy balance of resources on Earth, all while keeping energy flowing through living things. Okay, we've now covered how organisms capture energy using oxygen. But what happens when oxygen isn't present? In this case, is it possible for cells to make any energy at all? Well, actually they can, but it is not nearly as efficient at creating ATP as cellular respiration. Fermentation is a chemical process occurring without oxygen by which glucose is broken down to create ATP. The big difference between cellular respiration and fermentation is that one cycle of cellular respiration generates a whopping 38 ATP molecules, while fermentation only yields a measly 2 from the same amount of glucose. And to add insult to injury, fermentation creates byproducts like ethyl alcohol and lactic acid that clog up cells. The type of byproduct depends on the type of fermentation. If you've ever exercised so hard that you struggled to breathe and felt that heavy, achy feeling in your muscles, you know what lactic acid feels like. Your body performs lactic acid fermentation when your lungs can't keep up with the oxygen demands of your muscles, or there simply isn't any oxygen present. It's good to know our bodies have a backup system in place, but fermentation is definitely not a good way for us to obtain energy in the long term. Plants and other organisms can use fermentation as well, but typically only do so when oxygen is scarce. However, some organisms only use fermentation to generate ATP. Bacteria, such as lactobacillus, survive by using lactic acid fermentation. Yogurt and cheese are examples of food created from this fermentation process. Another example is yeast, which is a fungus that ferments sugars and is responsible for making bread rise or puff up when baked. As you can see, fermentation is important for a variety of organisms, either as a backup energy system or a main source of energy. Additionally, organisms that perform fermentation also release CO2 as a waste product, which helps plants photosynthesize. All right, we have now covered the basics of cellular metabolism, which is how organisms use chemical reactions to maintain life. One of these metabolic processes is photosynthesis, which harnesses the energy from sunlight to convert carbon dioxide and water into glucose and oxygen. Another process is cellular respiration, which uses the glucose and oxygen created by photosynthesis to create carbon dioxide, water, and ATP, which is the energy currency of living things. Glucose can also be used to create ATP through the process of fermentation. But this process is not nearly as efficient at creating ATP as cellular respiration. In our next lesson, we'll dive deeper into cellular processes as we unravel the mysteries of the cell cycle. Until then, I'm Caroline, and remember, life is full of wonders, so keep learning and don't ever stop wondering. Hey, hey.